Now we go to a few examples for section 3.2. First example, we calculate deviation. Ashley and Brandon are certified public accountants who work for a large accounting firm preparing tax returns for small business clients. Because tax returns are often filed close to the deadline, it's very important that the returns be prepared in a timely fashion. With not a lot of variability in the length of time it takes to prepare a return, the chief accountant kept careful track of the amount of time in hours for all the tax returns prepared by Ashley and Brandon during the last week of March that Ashley prepared for five returns. For 5 hours, 7 hours, 8 hours, 9 hours, and 11 hours, Brandon prepared for 3 hours, 5 hours, 7 hours, 11 hours, and 14 hours. So, first question, find the mean preparation time for each accountant. So, for Ashley, the mean mu, this is the sum of x divided by n. Sum of x, this is 5 plus 7 plus 8 plus 9 plus 11 over 5. So divide, we get 8 hours. For Brandon, the mean, this is 3 plus 5 plus 7 plus 11 plus 14 divided by 5. Again, 8 hours. So for two accountants spend the same mean amount of time in tax preparation. However, Brandon preparation time vary more than Ashley. If you compare, you see that the range of preparation for Ashley, this is, you take the largest is 11, minus the smallest, 5, you get 6 hours. While for Brandon, the maximum is 14 hours. Minus the minimum 3 hours is 11 hours. So that means the Brandon tax preparation time are more spread out and show greater variability, have more variation, and are more dispersed. The chief accountant probably prefers a more consistent tax preparation time with less variability. Now, we find the deviation. The deviation, you know, this is x minus mu. For Ashley, mu equal to 8, therefore 5 minus 8 is negative 3, 7 minus s is negative 1, 8 minus s is 0, 9 minus s is 1, and 11 minus s is 3. For Brandon, the deviation are 3 minus s is negative 5, 5 minus s is negative 3, 7 minus s is negative 1, 11 minus 8 is 3, and 14 minus 8 is 6. Now we calculate the population variances for Ashley and Brandon. Remember that to calculate population variances, we use the formula that it is the sum of the square of deviation divided by the total population. So we get deviation negative 3 square will be 9, negative 1 square will be 1, 0 square is 0, 1 square is 1, and 3 square is 9. So totally 20, and divide by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So divide by 5, we get 20 over 5 is 4. For Brandon, the population variances is negative 5 square, that means 25. Negative 3 square is 9. negative 1 squared is 1, 3 squared is 9, and 6 squared is 36. So totally 80, and divide by 5, we get 16. The population standard deviation, this is the square root of the population variances. Therefore, for Ashley, sigma A, this is square root of 4, that means 2. And for Brandon, sigma is square root of 16, that means 4. So, the standard deviation represents a typical deviation. That is, this is the value of sigma representing a distance from the mean that is representative for that data set. For example, the typical distance from the mean for Ashley and Brandon tax preparation time is 2 hours and 4 hours, respectively. Now, we compute sample variance and sample standard deviation. Suppose that we obtain a sample of psi n equal to 3 from Ashley population of tuck preparation times as follow: 5 hour, 8 hour, and 11 hour. So the Ashley sample is 5, 8, 11. So the sample mean x bar in this case, this is 5 plus 8 plus 11 divided by 3. So it's again 8, but this 8 is, we have the same mean with the other, but this is not all the time the same. Now, to compute the sample variance, S square, we take the sum of x minus x bar square over n minus 1. So x is 5, x bar is 8, so 5 minus s square. X is 8, x bar is 8, so 8 minus s square. X is 11. X bar is s, so 11 minus s square. So we get 3 square is 9, 0 square, and 3 square again. So 9 plus 9 divided by 2, so it equal to 9. And the standard sample, deviation s, this is the square root of s square, that means 3. So in most worst application, consistency is a great advantage. In statistical data analysis, less variation is often better, even though variability is natural and cannot be eliminated. Throughout the course, you will find out that smaller variability will lead to more precise estimates and higher confidence in conclusion. Now, next we go to application of empirical rule. We know that if the data distribution is band-shaped, then we can apply the empirical rule to find approximate percentage of data that lie within k standard deviation of the mean for k equal to 1, 2, 3. Now, let's take example. The College Board reports that the population mean MAT SAT score for 2014 is mu equal to 514, with a population standard deviation of sigma equal to 118, and assume the distribution of MAT SAT score is band-shaped. Find the percentage of MAT SAT score between 396 and 632, and compare
compute the percentage of math SAT score that are above 752 and 750. We see that mu minus 1 sigma, this is 514 minus 118 is exactly 396. And mu plus 1 sigma, this is 514 plus 118, so this is 632. So the interval 396 to 632, this is exactly the interval from mu minus 1 sigma to mu plus 1 sigma. That means this is a population that lies between mu minus 1 sigma to 1 plus sigma. By the empirical rule, this is about 68% of the data. Next, mu plus 2 delta, 2 sigma, this is 514 plus 2 times 118 equal to exactly 750. So, for sample, that lie between mu minus 2 sigma and mu plus 2 sigma. About 95% of the data are on that interval. That means about 5% of the data are outside that interval. But the graph is band-shaped. So mu minus 2 sigma, this is 278. On the interval from 278 to 750, around 95% of the score are on this interval. That means 5% of the score are outside that interval. And because of the symmetry, that means 2.5% are on the right and 2.5% are on the left. In other words, on the interval from 750 to 800, they are around 2.5%. of score that above 750. Now, what could we say if there is no band shape information? If there is no band shape information, then for the interval 396 to 632, this is the interval from mu minus sigma 1 sigma to mu plus 1 sigma. In this case, k equal to 1, and the Chebyshev rule cannot say anything because the Chebyshev rule work only when k is more than 1. Only when k more than 1. For the interval from 278 to 750, this is the interval from mu minus 2 sigma to mu plus 2 sigma. At least 3/4 or 75% of the data values will fall within these two numbers. That means on this interval, at least 75% of students get that score. If you use the empirical rule, you would get 95% on that interval. But from Chebyshev rule, we can say only that it is 75%. What's the reason? The reason because we don't know whether the shape here is band shape or not. Therefore, we cannot use the empirical rule. Okay. That's all for lecture 5.